we're gonna do it anyways, no matter what. So we had our GA, and mid GA, the city council gives us this permit and says, you know, we can move to a parking lot, you know, and they said that parking lot you can occupy because it's sanitary and because it's health regulations, but not the park over here. So we ended up having consensus and saying, all right, we'll sign this, we'll go camp over there. We did it, 3 days go by, and they canceled the permit because of sanitation and health. Exact same reason they put us there in the first place. That's their reasoning. It was completely contradiction. Yep.
Working with the city council to try to cooperate with their rules, and every time they put out some stupid restriction that we were breaking, we bent over backwards and started cooking the food off site. We did everything we could have possibly done. You know, and one of the things that each city saw happen, that we saw happen, the police force would send homeless people to the camp. So they went over in our places in Dallas, which have been the same for 50 years, where the homeless hang out, and told them, you're going to get arrested if you stay here. You can't stay here. Go over beside City Hall. There's a homeless camp over there.
Wow.
And so all the homeless would come to us.
Wow.
And of course there was drugs.
Some of the homeless, though, they actually became full-time occupiers.
Very responsible acting, some of them. You know, like the night watch and all that. But
well, Bev, wasn't Beverly?
I don't know, but I do know that
Beverly's one of my favorites.
Who's the guy that gave up the channel?
Cordell?
Otto.
Otto.
He was at one time homeless.
Did you guys end up having to get forcibly removed?
Yeah.
Like, when did you guys have to face off with the police? When was that?
November 17th.
Oh,
yeah,
man.
17th, because the 18th we had a protest, and I was getting ready for that, and therefore I wasn't in camp the night before, and I didn't know. Called me. I was calling one of the guys who organized a lot of things in camp to make sure he was coming to this hospital for this protest, and he's telling me, we got raided last night, a bunch of people got arrested. It was
weird. Yeah, they just sneaked attacked you.
Yeah.
Sneaked attacked us too. Like, you know, the first day when they cut off our permit and we said we're not moving, they sent the county sheriff out at us. And the county sheriff just tried to intimidate us, saying, you know, you guys have to leave right now, you know, or I'm going to be back, you know. And that's all he said. He didn't say when he's going to be back or what for. And we even said, wait a second, it's the middle of the day. The park doesn't close till 11 p.m. So what are you trying to tell us to leave right now for? And he didn't come back that night. He came back the next night. And he kind of scared us again. We all kind of like bent over backwards to move to the sidewalk for the night, you know, because he said, we're going to arrest you right here and now if you don't move. And we moved. He said, we'll be back again. He didn't come back that night or the next night. And then finally, you know, it was a Halloween night, you know, at midnight. So All Saints Day, November 1st. They shut down the whole street. We didn't see it coming. No cars were going by. It was eerie. And all of a sudden, I just saw a cluster of lights, little small flashlights. Just a cluster of lights just rushed the park. And I just hear zip ties, people getting thrown on the floor. I didn't know what the hell was going on, you know. And luckily, I was on the sidewalk, you know, and like I run over to the park. And I was right before I stepped onto the grass. I hear, "Freeze! You're arrest. Or you're under arrest." And I stop and I look around, and everyone's getting zip tied around me and getting arrested. So luckily I was still on the sidewalk, but I just started yelling at the cops and letting them know what the Constitution says, letting them know, you know, what's going on and how what they are, what they're doing, you know. So if you go look.
Because a lot of cities didn't happen until it happened to us, like around November, mid-November.
Yeah, no, we were one of the first, and I don't think. I don't don't think we were one of the major cities coordinated with like the national security. It was our city council, which was basically the heart of the 1%, because we have this valley where there's like, you know, immigrants on one side and then like crack dealers on one side, but then there's like the super rich right in the middle, you know, and it's a Republican district across because the Democrats and everyone else just don't, they're just the silent majority, you know, and it's all run by Palm Desert. So that's where we went. We went to the center of it all and we occupied their city, you know, where all the rich Mughals go. It's like Hollywood's Haven. And they didn't like that at all. They contracted Riverside County and brought them over with Palm Desert Police Department, Indian Wells Police Department, and all this. And they just coordinated right out of the city council. And it was horrible, man. But they spent lots of money on our tax dollars. I think $88,000 spent by the Palm Desert City. You know, $88,000 patrolling and monitoring us and organizing that arrest.
City to city, how much the police forces actually spent of tax dollars for the Occupy questions, for regular innocent citizens who wanted to protest the way socioeconomic system was going.
Yeah.
I think the city of Dallas, where we have a city manager here, I think the city manager colluded with or, you know, got the mayor to do something. I don't know if the mayor would have done. What do you think, Byron?
Well, our mayor is a pretty lousy character. We had to mic check him at the Earth Day celebration at Fair Park, which is a big public space right in smack in the middle of the poorest part of Dallas. And all these rich people come there to the opera. It used to be the opera until they moved downtown, but, you know, we had a music hall there, which used to be the symphony and the opera. And we have all the museums until we started building the arts district, and all the museums and stuff is now moved downtown. But at one time it really was weird because all the diamonds and minks and top hats were going to this place in the middle of South Dallas, our poorest, crack infested, prostitution, and it's a black neighborhood. It's just one of those things. The way it all came down in Dallas and the way city politics works here in Dallas is truly unique. This is a truly rich folks control town as well. And it's one reason why we started out when we first announced Occupy Dallas, come down, hundreds of people came out. And then it petered down to the core of us, which is like about 30 of us. And we're the ones who keep coming back and running Occupy Dallas.
That's exactly what happened to us. Yeah, when they came and arrested us, they actually dropped all charges except for five people, and they called it the Occupy Five or the Occupy Coachella Valley Five, and they're trying to pin the whole 88,000 on those five people. That's their fine for trespassing, supposedly, an unlawful assembly. Though our First Amendment says we have the right to peaceably assemble, it was unlawful assembly, and trespassing. So for that, they're going to be collectively fined $88,000, but they're fighting it in court. You know, when they dropped the other four people's charges, or I think there were six other people's charges, I think they lost a lot in that case. So
the Supreme Court hasn't actually taken up the case yet of right to gather, or freedom of speech in terms of right to occupy. It goes all the way back to the Founding Fathers days. So, I mean, you know, those laws just haven't had to be tested because everybody has a home, and if you don't have a home, you're homeless, and they have programs for that. So it's never, ever been tested. You know, we occupy our homes, so we've never had a reason to put, this is our country, these are our trees, and we've been cutting up the land and selling it from the very beginning. Warren Mosler is coming here on the 23rd. He's a big economic brain, economist, and he's considered, he's even in the encyclopedia as one of the originators of modern monetary theory. And he's traveling around, and he's a big ally of Occupy. And he's coming here to speak, and we have our own kind of miniature Warren Mosler that lives here and is occupied. Charles and I have been trying to get ready for Warren by doing an interview to make this whole thing about modern monetary theory understandable and simple. But it goes back to that. When they got here to colonize, they originally said, okay, is this land? This is just free land. If you got a back to work it, bring your wife, come here, have your kids here, build up and build this nation up. But almost within several years of the 1620 Plymouth colony, they were already selling it. They were already apportioning it and saying, okay, we're the city of Jamestown, and we decided that this land 100 miles to the west of Jamestown belongs to Jamestown, and you can only have it for so much gold. You know, so we already broke ourselves in the very beginning from natural human nature and greed, and we've never stopped. We've just gotten more rich man I own ever since.
Sounds like a scheme to make money, you know? Steal people's land and steal and sell it. Right?
It's human nature. Greed is human nature. There's a thing that says, here we are, the Occupy. Most of us are kind of poor or working stiffs or whatever. If you flipped it over and we had the millions, we'd start acting like them.
I hope not.
That's what the theory says.
Yeah, that's the theory.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, now, wait a minute. I'm going to bring up my favorite thing, which is called sacred economics and gift economy.
I love that, too. Yep.
You're familiar with sacred
economics? Charles Eisenstein,
yes.
Right? Yep.
Yes.
I love that guy. My favorite economist, yep.
Yes.
Definitely. I haven't heard of the modern monetary one, though.
Just go out and Google
like
it.
I'd like to look that one up, too, because we're looking for a new economy, you know?
They're very in favor of some dynamic things that are kind of different and scary, and I wish Charles was here to tell you about them directly. One of them is the guaranteed employment, which means that everybody in the country must have a job. No questions, no ifs, ands, or buts. Unless you're broke down, can't move your arms and your legs.
Or if you opt out, or if you sign something that say, I don't want a job, I want to sleep on the streets.
Right. And so here's this very strong plank of modern monetary theory, and then all this super complexity around it, about the Fed, about the gold standard, which no longer is there, the fact that our economy is not busted, we're not needing austerity because we're in deficit, there is no deficit. And I get so confused when he's trying to talk to me about that. So we're going to have this interview, and I get to ask the questions. I'm the live streamer for Dallas.
Nice.
And then we'll try to dumb it down. But me personally, my personal philosophy, socioeconomically and everything else, I'm a meritocrat. I believe in something called meritocracy, in which you learn things, right, naturally by your desire and your interests. Whatever you know, that's your rank in society. You can go no higher than what you know, and you can be no lower than what you know. You can't be disenfranchised because your last name is Rockefeller. You're going to be the king,
and
you're black, so you're going to be naturally low. No. If you know more than Rockefeller, you're going to have more money than him. So
like
that's
that,
a meritocracy.
Yeah.
And it kind of scares
because you still have
Charles.
The hierarchy. Yeah. You still have the hierarchy, I think that it's based on something that will actually progress a society, because you know, that's the big issue that we're all, in my opinion, we're all trying to raise awareness, raise consciousness, educate the people, you know. So if education is the key, if we need to learn our democratic system so that we can take our government back, if we need to learn where the products are coming from and where our money's going so that we can be conscious consumers, we need to know our neighbors and know, you know, how to have a good time out here and love and live happily. You know, these are things we need to learn. So I think education definitely, if that is the profit motive instead of dollar bills, that'll raise up our community.
One thing you said when we were coming up from the colonial days to talk about the structure of economics, and you said if you opt out, you can live on the streets. in the meritocracy, well, at least in the one I wrote about in a novel I wrote, you could opt out. You don't have to work. You don't have to study. And there got to be people who don't want to study. And you know what they had? They designed something called the AgriCorps, which was native food-bearing plants for miles and miles around every big city, which they cleared off the small cities so the ecology could resume. Only the big cities were made into, like, city-states.
Kind of like the Venus Project.
Made into city-states, like printing was in Pittsburgh and entertainment was in Los Angeles. These were castles. But all around the temperate ones, where it was warmer, there was a natural food swath. I called it the AgriCorps. And you could go and pick food and come back to your free home. You didn't have to participate in the guild system and rise up in the ranks as a printer at Pittsburgh. You could live in Pittsburgh, at least in the summer, I guess, and go and pick apples or whatever and come back and feed your granny. You didn't have to participate in the system. And they even set up castles, which was administered by the people who wanted to be in the game of protection. What's left of our police and our FBI and our politicians, that's the protection guild. It actually is a valid endeavor of human industry. So they got a castle in D.C. and in Moscow, but they also had to set up a castle in Bogota and in New Delhi, and which was a free castle for people who were ungilded, didn't want to learn, didn't want to do anything, but the food was very rich. And the wildlife. So you could live there, you could hunt, you could go and pick a bunch of apples and pay a hunter in apples, you know, and get meat. Yeah. You didn't have to participate.
That sounds awesome.
It's a weird novel.
Yeah. With those people who lived off of the wildlife or the free land, would they have a home inside of the city, or would they be able to live out in the...
Because some of the money was paid to the protection guild in a tax from the other guilds, there was money to provide homes in New Delhi and Bogota. However, to live in Pittsburgh, you were kind of on your own. It was like at first there was a lot of housing because they understood that people weren't making up their minds what they want to dedicate their lives to. And so they were just remaining ungilded in the city where they lived. So mortgage went away, and case by case, they were saying, he's living here, he hasn't made up his mind, there's no rush, there's no law, we're going to continue to let him live here rent free, but he's going to have to start to figure out, he needs to go out into the woods, into the AgriCorps, and get some apples and peaches, and maybe trade with a hunter if he doesn't know how to hunt for meat.
Yeah, because... I mean, if you just let them alone to fend off in the wilderness, they can end up building a crazy city and industrialize, or you know, barbarians, or start thieving, or just ruin the natural ecology. So yeah,
like
you could
the
have,
Occupy of the future.
Yeah, so you would want them to have houses. Yeah,
thank you.
Absolutely.
Well, a set of people, according to what I, is predictive fiction, and a set of people actually decided, we don't like any of it, so we're going to be nomads. Because when it's cold in the north, we're going to go south to pick our fruit and stuff and hunt. And they started calling themselves by a certain name, the Chai Chai and other things. And they were non-participants in any shape or form. They didn't want to live in Bogota or Colombia, as beautiful as they are, or you know, or New Delhi, as beautiful as that would be, you know, if it wasn't all this population and pollution and stuff.
Yeah.
The world is a beautiful place. I mean, it can support us all.
And some people do want to travel. So maybe if they had some kind of, like if you've heard of the, I forget what it's called, I think it's a New World Charter, something like that, where, and I might be wrong, but I don't know. I read this charter that has like these universal rights that we could all agree to, and you know they're trying to collect signatures to say we all agree that these are natural law, you know, and like for example, if you wanted to be nomadic in that you know predicted fiction, you would have to live by certain rules. Like for example, I don't know much about socialism. I haven't read Marx, but I do know a little about Locke and Adams and capitalism. So, for example, to relate that, in capitalism, Locke talks about you can't take from the natural resources more than you leave. You have to leave more than you take. You know, that would have to be a natural law, you know what I mean? So that if nomads are coming through, they don't just scavenge the whole field and take off, you know what I mean?
The Protection Guild in D.C. are cops.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, and they therefore
have to be policies,
yeah.
Though,
I mean, they would come in with guns and everything else, and say, "We're not gonna let you try to despoil the whole of the agriculture of Atlanta."
Yeah,
because there are free living people in Atlanta without a guild that depend on this food.
Yeah,
you know, so there are rules, and we're gonna stand here with, we're not gonna shoot you, but we're gonna stand here with our guns and protect these apple trees. I mean, there were situations like that. For the roaming, I just predict that if you had this big set of people, and it wouldn't be that big a set because you get the free car and the free house to go ahead and move somewhere and declare, "I want to work in that field."
Yeah.
So that wouldn't really be that many.
Yeah, there wouldn't, of course. I mean, you know, I'd be like, "Hey, I want to be in the security guild. I'm off, you know, I'm going to go live there, I'm going to learn as much as I can. The more I learn, the higher I'm going to rise in rank."
And the less motivated friends of yours who wanted you not to, to want to just hang out would be, "Don't go, let's be part of the Chaita. They're coming through here next week, and let's just hang, you know." And you'd be, "I'm getting a free car, a free house, and I've been learning all this stuff already from schools and internet. So I'll probably get a rank."
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to go and I'm going to let the computer rank me against these other guys, and I'm going to begin life at court with the king.
Yeah.
Everybody gets a chance to speak to the king of security.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm not going to be voiceless. It's a big castle. It's a family. I'm going to join the security family.
That would be great. You know, musicians would just go to the entertainment thing and everything.
Vienna or wherever.
Yeah, exactly. And,
I have a question. Is the musician capital in Memphis or San Francisco? Where's the music?
No, and there's mistakes because I'm a mortal and I just wrote it out as best as a novelist could. Entertainment is in Los Angeles, including popular music.
Okay.
But music specifically was in Vienna, where the classicists
were. That makes more sense.
Yeah. And then there was Paris, which also had a piece of the music, the orchestral. And it was very mixed up.
Yeah.
And they were called envoys to the main castle, and there was some debate. We're where it really belongs. I put the sports guild in Nashville, because it's just entertainment.
Yeah.
And so country and western may not like that, but they're more central to music entertainment to me, so they need to go to Cass Los Angeles and compete there.
Yeah, that'll work.
With the rest of the musicians and the actors. You know, there's crossover.
Yeah, you could travel for a little while. You're still young. You can go travel with the nomads and have that kind of lifestyle for a little while. And then you'll discover what you really love. You know, "Oh, I want to be a farmer. I want to be a, you know, whatever you want to do."
Agriculture.
And, and then you get to it, you know, and that, I think that would be a great society. Thank you for writing
interesting novel.
thank you for writing that.
Yeah, I have a chance to maybe get it published soon. I have a friend online named publisher connection. Because that's a 1% game, too. Publishing is a 1% game. They control publishing. Okay, let's break this up. Because he wants to know if you have a table. Because...